John Golan with growingyourgreens.com to have another exciting episode for you. And of all the places in the world I am, I'm here in Canada, I'm here in Kelowna, British Columbia. This is a beautiful town, beautiful place, been having fun here. But the reason for this episode today is to share with you guys one incredible garden that actually I got to see last year, but I didn't get to film a video for various reasons. But this year I'm here to show this to you, and this garden is totally amazing. It's basically a mulch garden, and this is the kind of gardening I want you guys to do because it produces higher quality food than just using bagged compost from the local nursery or, you know, the local landscaper, right? Now, the first thing I want to show you guys is this is not the garden behind me. This is basically maybe the parkway. I guess the city owns the land right at the end of the fence, all the way to the street, but it's the owner's responsibility to maintain it, I guess. And so this is what maybe many people's parkway may look like. It may be green, like maybe down the street a little bit is a little more green. This is a little bit brown with a few plants. And to me, this does not look that pretty. I mean, yeah, maybe it's kind of functional if you got kids or you got a dog and you got a nice place to go to the bathroom. But it's not super functional. You know, what I want to do next is actually take you across the street to show you guys, you know, a parkway that at one point was even handicap accessible and beautiful, providing habitat for the creatures such as bees and different, you know, insects. Also provides food for the people that live here. Totally amazing. And also kind of artistic in its own way. I mean, there's some seating. If you get tired, you want to sit down, you can have a seat. And, you know, you're sitting down on a chair, and right behind you got, you know, like squash is growing. Right? We have edible nasturtiums right here. You know, these are just like nice edible flowers right here. You guys could eat the beautiful flowers, and many people don't know you could also eat the leaves. When the leaves are getting this big, actually, I like to make a nice, you know, vegetable wrap and just wrap these up into like a little wrap. And this is like the wrapper. So instead of buying tortilla shells, you have nasturtium leaf shells. These will add a little bit of spice and flair to the food that you're eating. And maybe you'll even clear out your sinuses too. And then down below this, check this out, man. He's got all these like quartz crystals right here, right? And there's something to this gemology stuff, right? Quartz crystals, right? They got energy. If you're into crystals and all this stuff, you guys know about quartz. And I want to tell you, I walked around this guy's whole property, and the best growing arugula, he has lots of wild arugula growing, mostly because it's wild and he didn't reseed it, it reseeds itself. The best arugula he's got growing is right here next to the quartz because it's being infused with the quartz energy. Maybe there's some minerals coming off the quartz. I mean, there's nothing different than this arugula than the arugula over here, you know. And the leaves over on this side are super small, but the leaves on that side are super big. So maybe you guys should have some quartz in your ground. But let me tell you, when I eat this wild arugula, man, the flavor is like no other. There's like a flavor depth and a sweetness that you're getting. And of course, it's also lighting up my mouth with some fire right now. But this is good, right? I mean, if you just buy arugula in like that, you know, the bulk bin organic, you know, in the plastic tote, it's like eating nothing. There's like no flavor. There's maybe a mild bit of, you know, heat to it. This stuff is like powerful medicine, you know? And like Hippocrates said, let food be thy medicine and medicine be thy food. And this guy, in my opinion, is growing food that is medicine because of the high quality and because of the way he takes care of his soil that he's been doing, man, since probably the 80s. This guy's been old school gardener. Anyways, let me go ahead and show you guys around more just this parkway on the outside of his property and what kind of food he's growing. All right, so along this parkway strip, he has lots of things planted, you know, such as apple trees. Here's like an apple. He also has sunflowers, which are beautiful. You could use for cut flowers, or the bees and the different pollinators love that. In addition, if you look closely, he has basically these raised beds. So it's like, you know, he's got these nice shingles around it. And he's growing things like the castor bean, which is a toxic, poisonous plant. You don't want to grow this or eat it or anything like that. But he likes how it looks. And more recently, actually, I found out that the castor bean plant is actually a host plant for a certain kind of beneficial insect that eats thrips. So if you grow peppers, you might have these things called thrips. Like I always get thrips on my peppers. If you have this plant, it can attract the beneficials that will actually eat thrips, which is really cool, which is something recently I learned about. He has the mountain spinach, or orach, that's currently growing in its flowering stage. And just along here, he has more nasturtiums, more of the wild arugula. And if you look back closely along the wall here, I mean, he's got some of the, you know, cypress or whatever, but he also has cucumber vining through it. And actually, earlier I spotted a cucumber that he didn't know was there. It was like at least, 18 inches long. Over here, look at this, like all this wild mountain spinach right here, the borac. Look at how huge this plant is. And this guy, we can't see it from here, but he has some corn that you guys are gonna see. It's like 25 feet tall. It's like insane. Oh, and check this out, man. He does all these cool projects. Like, aside from just growing cool stuff, he's growing in a lot of different ways. So basically, these are like those water pipes that the city sends water to like residences, and he's repurposing these. And he basically just stacked them up. And he stacked them up in such a way so that he could have a tomato plant here, 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 and it's all, everything's on automatic irrigation here. So, I mean, really, he's maximizing the use of his space by growing vertically. And I said, hey man, you should grow something underneath here. Because something should be coming and vining out of the bottom, and he's not. But anyways, looks good otherwise. I guess he's growing over 30 varieties of different kinds of tomatoes here on the property. Now, you know, to you, this may look a little bit wild in here. Look at this. This is like, those are just weeds, John. Well, a lot of this is food, and if it's not food for us, it's food for the insects. In addition, if you look really closely here, you can see along here, I mean, these are all basically onion chives he has planted as a little nice, walkway thing. You could step on the stone in the middle so you don't step on the chives. And then up over here, he has a patty pan squash. Look at this. Here's one just growing right here. Nice little baby. He pulled off some nice huge ones a little bit earlier. Definitely having some powdery mildew on the squash, but they're not affected. Luckily, he doesn't have any squash bugs that I saw. But yeah, I think that's pretty much it for the outside I want to show you guys. Now I want to take you to the creme, la de creme, the inside of his garden, where he's actually growing on roofs, he's growing in pots, he's growing in raised beds, he has mulch beds, and it's just really well decorated. I mean, he's put a lot of work into this garden here. And I wanted to share with you guys, and I want you guys to teach you guys some techniques that he's doing that hopefully might inspire you guys as well. So now I want to take you guys into Angel's Roost. This is like his entryway with like some stone beam. He used to have a light bulb up there and a little gate. And I want to give you guys a forewarning, right? This guy really likes to reduce, reuse, and recycle. Whether he's reducing, reusing, recycling, he likes to repurpose a lot of things. So, I mean, there's a lot of things kind of hanging out in here. And this is a busy guy. He has a business. He's trying to clean out a house. He's trying to do this, trying to do that. And his garden is always work in progress. He has always so much to do. And this garden has progressed so much since I was here last year. I guess he has a well in now, and he has all these grand ideas. He put in a spiral staircase, and I might get to show you guys like so many things. So there are some, you know, things and storage and whatnot, but this is how it is, you know, and I would encourage you guys actually to repurpose things. I think there's too much trash and waste, and if something has a value that maybe you may be able to use in the future for something, right? Save and use it. Of course, if things don't have a purpose, then I would encourage you guys to let it go. Maybe a free cycle near you, put it on Craigslist, give it away for free. Like I gave away these old like trellises that were basically rusting. And to me, they're not valuable anymore. They're rusting. I don't want like things flaking off in my garden. But somebody was glad to take them from me, and they're gonna use them, and they don't care that they're rusting or they're, you know, all the vinyl coating stuff is coming off. Hey, that's great, but at least it didn't go to the landfill. Anyways, let's head inside and show you guys this garden. So coming inside immediately, what you guys are gonna be greeted at is inside, and you know, I wanna point out a few things. Like, this guy has thought about a lot of stuff. Number one, all this stonework, he's laid all this himself. And because this is Canada, we are here in August right now. The weather's nice, but you know, what you guys don't understand is there will be snow here. I mean, I'm not really live in a place where there's snow. So actually he made this so that it's actually like sloped like this. I mean, this is an exaggeration, so that when he's sweeping it, all the water will go off to the edges. You know, in addition, he's covering the ground with all the stonework, but he's not making it, impermeable. So like the concrete sidewalks are impermeable. When it rains, the water washes off, has to go somewhere, goes in the storm drains, you know, goes out to lakes, can pollute things. With this, all the water that comes down is actually going through the holes between the blocks, and then basically storing it into the soil where it should be, that could then feed his plants, also give his earthworms and his microbes, keep them alive in the winter time. In addition, he's built basically raised beds out of just different concrete blocks, and he's basically doing what's called mulch gardening. So you know, this guy's been gardening here in this spot pretty much for 20 years now, since like 2000. And every year he collects the free leaves that people get rid of, they throw away, and he collects those, and he'll basically layer mulch on. And over the winter time, you know, in the fall, he collects the leaves, he puts it on, it gets snowed on in the winter, and the mulch acts as an insulation to keep the worms and all the microbes and everything alive underneath. And he piles on like a bunch, and then over the winter, it basically degrades down, and then he has some of the best soil that I've seen anywhere, right? This is known as leaf mold compost, and leaf mold compost is about 50% bacterial-based and 50% fungal-based. The fungal base is what we really want in vegetable gardens, in my opinion. You know, most vegetable gardens don't have any significant fungal activity, which then really hurts the production and hurts the plant's health, right? The healthier plants are by having more of a balanced system in your soil, the healthier crops will be. Actually, here's one right here. Look at this cucumber. I mean, I just noticed this cucumber. This cucumber here is like pushing 2 feet long. It's a nice Armenian cucumber. And then if we just go up from here, right? Like, I'm about 6 feet tall, ladies. But this trellis, look at this trellis here. This trellis must go up at least 20 feet tall. And you guys look, I mean, he's got purple beans up here. He's got purple beans up there. I mean, this basically trellis goes up and then it arches up and over the top. So the beans will grow. I mean, that's totally insane. I mean, here's some nice purple beans. And if you guys grow beans, I want you guys to grow some purple beans. Wow, actually that's a sweet bean. Now look at these guys, and we'll get you a better shot of these. All right, so check this out, man. This is the world's tallest, well, maybe not the world's tallest corn, but the tallest corn I've ever seen in my life. I mean, I'm standing right next to it, and look at this, it goes up and up and up. It's so tall, it's hard to even fit in on the camera shot. And I'm gonna estimate this is like maybe 25 feet tall corn. I mean, literally, he's gonna have to stake this stuff. Pretty soon the wind's gonna take it, and it might even break it. And this is actually corn that actually produces corn. It's called Cusco corn from South America. So like probably an heirloom variety. Totally insane. Now, of course, variety may play a factor in how large the corn is, but definitely the soil plays even a bigger one, in my opinion. And some of the world record growers for the biggest crops really pay attention to having excellent soil. So I would encourage you guys to do that also. Let's go ahead and continue our tour. Get this. So down below the corn, he has, you know, beans, of course, growing up the corn, and then also on the trellis behind the corn. And then in front of it, he has things like dinosaur kale, standard kale. And some of this kale actually is destined to going into some of the ferments. He has a company, I think it's called Moonstone Ferments. And he ferments and makes for lots of fermented vegetables because he's really into the microorganisms, which are critical to not only our health and our microbiome, but also the soil health and ecology as well. He really loves actually specifically the curly kale, and it has all these folds, which, you know, to me are folds that get like bugs and things, but he's also collect wild yeast and bacteria that are floating in the air. And when he ferments them, you know, he feels that they have a lot more there. And you know, I'm looking through some of these leaves, you know, and if it was kale in my garden, it probably has some aphids, but I'm not, you know, seeing any major aphid infestations, you know, on this kale. Maybe just a little bit, you know, and that surprises me for all the kale and stuff he's growing. Look at this, on both sides of me, he has different kale and collard greens growing, like so much stuff. Anyways, let's go down this side of the garden and show you guys actually how he's growing and how you guys could grow. Even if you don't have any space to grow, you grow in containers or pots, which he has an amazing pot garden. Like literally, he's growing pots, not pot, pot in pots. So if you guys look, he has all these basically, I don't know, granite and marble slabs here. But behind it, he basically has just these like 5 gallon pots, and he's growing different things. I mean, this one has peppers in it, and he's basically just lined them up and stacked them right next to each other, right? And so all these pots have like one pepper plant. This pepper plant's looking really nice. Look, it even got some little peppers on here. Maybe there's some habaneros or something. Going down the way. And in this big pot here, he's basically growing vining cucumbers up the side, and he's hoping it'll just basically attach on to the cypress or whatever this is above it, which it is, and growing above. So he really likes to make the maximum use of vertical space. And there's so much going on in this garden. If we just turn to this side, on this side, you know, he's growing these guys. These are called cucamelons. and they look like a watermelon, but these guys are not watermelons. They're like super small. So I'll hold this up for you guys so you guys can see it. These are actually cucumbers, and we're gonna try this. I love these cucumbers. They're nice and crunchy, and they have a little bit of a pickly taste. And they do great here. I mean, these vines have just been taken over. You have so many of these fruits, like these little mini watermelon fruits to eat. I don't think he could possibly eat them all, so I'm gonna help him take a couple with me. But aside from that, you know, even here in August, because the weather's cooler here in Kelowna, he has some sugar snap peas growing still. So he's like, look, here's a nice sugar snap pea. We're gonna go ahead and try that. Actually, that was a shell pea. But good nonetheless. He is getting some powdery mildew on some of those guys. But this whole wall is basically a trellis, 6 feet tall, and just growing this nice binding plant. Now, I do want to say, if you guys grow in a heat area, so like I'm growing the same exact plant in 100 degrees, and it's leaping out like crazy. And I think I saw one fruit on it. So in the heat, it doesn't like it, but in this climate, it loves it and is producing tons of fruit. Over on this side, more pots. I think these are like maybe 2 gallon pots. And look, in a 2 gallon pot, you could grow lots of cool stuff. He has like basil in this pot, also some strawberry spinach growing down below. If we go down further, you know, he even has like this, smaller basil. He has thyme. He has his castor beans that he likes. Going down further, he has onions and anise. He's got some red variegated sorrel down here. And this is the part that I like. He's got, the purple basil. Here's more of that corn coming up just in a 2 gallon pot. We come down further, you know, once you get on this side, he has like runner beans growing that are dried up. Maybe these are from last year. He has some beans that are dried up. And then down over here, look at this. This is beauty to my eyes. Like, if you guys grow basil, I want you guys to grow this kind of basil. This is like deep purple basil. Not only does this have that basil flavor that we all know and love and expect, but also this has something different, right? Because this is purple, this has purple anthocyanins, which are the purple color pigments, right? These purple pigments can really positively impact our health, in my opinion. You know, the purple basil is at least 3 times more healthful to eat than the green basil. But they could be grown in the same exact space, same exact requirements and conditions. I'd encourage you guys always to grow the purple. But I love this. And actually, this is a nice mild tasting basil as well. So he has like a purple ruffled basil and then a standard purple basil over here. And then it will be like a pan this way. You can see more of his mulch garden. And look at all the leaves that he's basically growing in. This is probably the best mulch you guys could use in your garden as well, just leaves. So one of the things he's really doing here is he's literally growing above grade. This is something I think can be beneficial depending on where you live and your climate and how you're growing. So you can see this is like the standard level. This is the level of the steps and the pathway. But then if you look at his growing beds are at least another foot higher. This allows him to continue to pile on mulch and make the mulch thicker and thicker, because as the mulch breaks down, it brings up the soil level higher and higher. So he could just have more basically mulch leaves on mulch leaves. And he's been doing this now for nearly 20 years to create some really good soil. And the taste of the crops, and I've tasted plenty here today, definitely explain that to me and show that to me, as well as the health of the crops, as well as the production, right? The healthier guys' soil, the more production you could get. So let me go ahead and show you guys actually how productive some of his tomatoes are. Gonna walk here, and he basically has these blocks so you don't step on actually the garden itself and all the mulch. And here are some of these tomatoes. Where was I gonna go? Oh, I was gonna go right here. Look at this tomato plant. Does your tomato plant have this many tomatoes on it? I mean, that's insane. I mean, that's like at least a dozen tomatoes, and this is on like freaking seriously like one branch. Like, that's so insane. And this is literally the secret to his garden where I'm standing right now. I'm standing on a block, but basically he's basically growing on these leaves that people get rid of every fall when the leaves fall, you know, drop all their leaves, right? So if we just move this stuff away, I wanna show you guys what's underneath. So right now I'm digging the mulch away and I'm at least down at 8 inches. And finally, when I get to 8 inches down, you guys can see inside here, there's maybe some, like, instead of fresh leaves, there's like black leaves that are basically, like, you know, all wet. These are kind of wet and slimy. And if I keep going down further, I'm probably good 8 inches down. Now we got all these little roly-poly creatures. I don't know what they are. They're like little millipedes or who knows what. And then if we go down further, they're like eating the leaves. Look at that. All those guys are eating the leaves. They're basically pooping out and they're basically decaying the leaves, turning it into soil. We keep going down further. We're probably gonna hit, you know, like earthworms. We go down further. Finally, we hit, like, look at this stuff, man. This is rich black soil. This is probably the best soil you guys could make, because literally it's made from the natural decomposition slowly over time, you know, without any kind of like heat. You know, these are basically carbon composting in a slow method. You know, there's fungi, there's bacteria. Man, this soil is just really nice to stick your hand into. It's like nice and fluffy stuff. Let me go ahead. Oh wow, man, this is a nice earthy smell, super rich. And this is how everybody should be making their soil, man. Just like letting leaves rot, collecting all your neighbor's leaves. Hey, fall is coming up, man. Leaves are quite valuable. Don't just dispose of them. And if your neighbors are throwing them out, you know, ask if you could grab theirs. You know, he probably drives around the city in the fall and starts grabbing leaves because, you know, I don't know how many leaves he's piled on every year after year, but that's literally how his garden's growing. He doesn't spend money on compost to bring it in. He just been mulching leaves year after year religiously. And that's super important. I really like this garden. It's like, instead of like straight, it's kind of spiral. So I'm like kind of walking back through here. You can see the pathway has been, you know, I'm walking on the blocks, but right to the side, it's basically all the mulch. And look at this. This is his, you know, beautiful curly kale. And he's basically mulched up totally to the stalk of it, like right underneath, which, you know, to me, that would be like a slug haven, but evidently he doesn't have too many slugs. I mean, I see very little slug damage or anything. So that's totally amazing. Over here, he's got some Swiss char that's going to bolt. And then also he has all these stakes, you know, going up that basically is tying up all his tomato plants, which are doing quite well. Following around here, he's got maybe some like garlic growing, some more Swiss char, maybe some, all different kinds of stuff in here. Mostly lots of tomatoes, and then I like really how he's growing the kale as the understory and the tomatoes as the overstory. So these guys are just low, and then he has the tomatoes up high, but then even below the kale, he's got the mulch down below there as well. So another thing he does really a lot is grow vertically. So if something is vining, he's usually gonna grow that vertically if he has any choice. And basically he made a trellis here out of rebar and this wire fencing material, or maybe concrete remesh, and he's growing cucumbers up this, like kind of at a slant. And this is probably trellis is like 15 feet tall. And you can see all these nice, basically cucumbers on there. I think these are like, you know, I don't know, nice style, like more Japanese style cucumbers or hothouse cucumbers. Now, he does have some powdery mildew. John, if he's growing mulch and everything's growing good, man, why does he got powdery mildew? Right, powdery mildew happens to the best of us. It's actually quite humid here in Kelowna. This is something I don't get. But even if your plants get powdery mildew, right, they can still be productive. Like this has powdery mildew here, up here has some, but all the new growth has very little and the plant is still productive. So just because you have powdery mildew doesn't mean it's a bad thing. You know, if you want to make some kind of like milk or baking soda solution to spray on here, that might take it out. The other thing you might do is just cut off the bad leaves that are affected, because now the powdery mildew is growing here and this could spread to other leaves, right? And if the powdery mildew is covering the whole leaf surface, the leaf is not able to photosynthesize anyway, so you might as well just cut it out. And the other better way is to, in my opinion, use bacteria to crowd out or to eat the powdery mildew. So I think there's one called Actinivate, and Actinivate is a special bacteria that actually eat up powdery mildew, which is a biologic approach. All right, so now I'm sitting next to some lettuce here, some lettuce in his garden. He's actually letting go into flower and seed, and then he'll collect the seed and then spread the seeds amongst his neighbors, like literally. Here's some lettuce that I want to try because I heard it was super good, and I haven't tried like a nice baby tenderleaf. I've been trying some bolting lettuce here. And lettuce is underestimated, man. If you ever have like romaine hearts from the store, like they're pretty flavorless to me, right? if you guys grow your own food and do it in really good soil that has good mineral content, right? The food is gonna have flavor depth, and this is something that if you're a gardener, you will know because you've had your own homegrown tomatoes, compare those to store-bought tomatoes. But even homegrown, you know, lettuce, kale, green beans, they could all be significantly higher nutrition. And when they're higher nutrition, and you're growing in this method, they're likely also gonna be higher in protein as well as the trace minerals. So we're gonna look at this nice lettuce here. We're gonna go ahead and try that, let you guys know what I think. I'm a human bricks meter. Wow. Gotta tell you, I've been visiting like aquaponics farms and hydroponics farms growing lettuce. I gotta say, this guy's soil grown mulch, based lettuce, some of the best I've tasted. So now I want to show you guys what is gold in his garden. Literally, what is gold in his garden here is this bag. You're like, John, that's a bag of garbage, man. It's like a bag of leaves. The bag is decomposing. It's been sitting here so long. I mean, what you guys don't understand is that the leaves that people throw away, this is probably some of the best fertilizer you guys could use for your garden. Now, it's not necessarily fertilizer when it's in this form, but let this sit for a couple years, and this bag has been sitting literally for 2 years now, and it's just starting to break down. It really makes the black gold. This is like what it's called, mulch gardening, and actually its website is actually mulch gardening. That's the name of the website. I'll post a link down below. You should check it out. His website could use some work. But we really want to value the leaves and start using those as mulch. I mean, people say, John, should I use wood chips as mulch in my garden? Wood chips do not break down that fast. I would encourage you guys to use tree leaves as one of my favorite mulches to use in your garden. And let it break down, even over the winter. Actually, collect all the leaves, and if you live in a place with snows, collect all your leaves, in the fall, put them on your garden, let them just break down over the winter. That's probably the best thing you guys could do for your property. Because the other thing is this, right? When you put the leaves down, it's gonna insulate the ground. This acts as an R, 10 or 5 or who knows what. It keeps the ground warmer so your earthworms could live. And people say, oh, earthworms die in the winter time. No, they die if you don't have your soil covered, if they don't have a good home. If you mulch heavily, right, you're gonna create a nice microclimate for your worms and other bacteria, soil bacteria, fungi, all these creatures to live so they could do the work. They're gonna work slower in the wintertime, of course, because it's colder out, but they're gonna stay alive and continue the food soil web, which is so important to growing healthy food. I just had to give you guys a quick break. I mean, he's got all these, this is like a big kid's like playground here. He's got like this spiral staircase going up in the trees where he's gonna have his yoga platform. Let me just go up here a little bit. And this is all repurposed right here from a tree. Hey, maybe I'll swing down this rope. Whee, I'm burning my fingers. All right, anyways, I can play Tarzan and swing over to something. Whee! But let me go ahead and show you guys actually what he's growing on one of the roofs of his sheds. Check this out. This is one of the exterior parts of his property next to his driveway, and he has like this little shed here that he's gonna be doing lots of stuff in. But even down below, he has like nasturtiums growing. He has this stuff here, which is some kind of a like mountain spinach, and he also has like beans growing up these little spirals up to the top. And then check that out up on the roof, right? He's got containers. I think that's like maybe 15 gallons. Containers of tomato plants, and up there even further he has basically totes, like the plastic totes that he's cut down. He's growing corn and cucumbers in. So actually I want to take you guys up there. So let's come up on that roof. We got a ladder here. All right, come on up. So look at this, man. Basically he used basically pieces of wood to kind of like so these pots aren't like sloped down, they're kind of like more on level. You guys can see there's wood here, and he basically put wood underneath it. And he's basically got tomatoes growing up on the roof, which is insane. Even more insane, well, he's storing his canoe up here. But look at this, he's got this tote on the roof. This is literally the roof, right? Let me see if I can lift this up. I can barely lift it up, actually. But that is heavy, that's like at least, 200 pounds. And that's being supported on the roof. I mean, what better place to grow some food than your roof? Only do this if it's legal to do so where you are, and the roof is not gonna cave in, right? Especially when putting soil in pots, think it can get very heavy. I have a roof in my backyard, basically like an awning thing, and I wanna grow hydroponically up there because I'm not gonna have to have any soil on the roof. But you know, the roofs, they collect a lot of sunlight, which are wasted space. You know, another part of his property here, he's actually just heating up jugs of water, which then he could pour out over himself to basically have a hot shower using the power of the sun, right? The power of the sun literally makes this whole planet work. It lets plants grow, you know, and literally it feeds us. So I want you guys to use more sun power as literally free power whenever you can by heating water, you know, letting leaves absorb the sun and create energy, or even have solar panels on your house, which is one of my goals in the near future. So what do you guys think so far, man? There's so many other things I could show you guys at this place, but I'm running out of time here. But I did want to show you guys this picture here. So this is a before picture of how this yard used to look. Literally, I mean, it was just, you can see the cypress growing around, which is still there. But there's basically a lawn, and he had this the pathway right in the middle, which he kind of kept to this date, but he basically raised up. And this is when he basically started this project around 2000. And then maybe like in 2002, this is what it looked like. So you can see he's starting the mulch beds, and he's got all the beds planted out, a similar format with that one major pathway. And over the years, which has been like, this is now over 15 years later, he continues to just keep piling up mulch. You know, I mean, I know there's a guy in the US that's made like wood chip gardening very popular. And while I do think wood chips are very valuable for like orchards and fruit trees, I definitely think that vegetable gardens will and can benefit more from using the leaves as a mulch, right? So that's what I would encourage you guys to do. Now, the last part of this episode, what I wanna do is I'm gonna interview Daniel, the gardener, the farmer, the creator here, to share with you guys more about his amazing mulch garden and how he's been trying to educate people about this method of gardening for many years now. And even does fermentations, and this guy is a wealth of knowledge. So stay tuned for the interview coming right up. So now I have the pleasure of introducing to you guys Daniel, the dancing gardener, whose place I got to show you guys. And Daniel, is it true you guys, you've been doing mulch gardening now and spreading the knowledge of mulch gardening for the last 38 years?
You betcha.
Now, why did you get into mulch gardening of all different things? I mean, 38 years ago, that was like back in the day, you know, like before gardening was really even popular.
Well, it didn't make sense. The soil was bare. It was being exposed to weeds. Nobody of my age wanted to do any gardening because it was bred out of us, because everybody had to sit there and kill life by pulling all the little weeds out of the ground all the time. So anyone of my generation, our parents and our grandparents got us kids to do the weeding. So an old hippie video that, or not a video, it was an actual film. It was an actual film.
Like you saw it in grade school, right?
Yeah, I saw it in like grade six. So like this is a long, long time ago. And these hippies had a commune, and they were growing things with straw, and you didn't see any exposed soil. And the guys were just going in under the soil, under the straw, and pulling out potatoes and things that were just resting on the ground. And it just made perfect sense how everything was all breaking down. So I created a small mulch garden, and I used leaves instead of straw. And I have done it, I've done actually large productions where I have used those great big rolls of straw and spread it out over fields, and done actual production gardening for growing my cabbages and stuff where the soil is always exposed.
And it's just, always covered, not exposed.
It's always covered. So it's just like your skin. It's just like your skin. All of the leaves and all of the organic matter is covering over your flesh, right? So in Mother Nature, you don't have exposed soil, okay? It's always covered up with organic matter. Things are always going to grow on it. You know, it's just like Monsanto doesn't work because life is always going to be there. So the whole trick is to put all your time and effort into having the soil covered. Okay, whether it's newspaper, ew, you know, or plastic, ew, you know, like that's all horrible things. But if you're going to get into a fight with a worm, okay, you know, you're not going to win if you're going to try to say what it wants more than anything else. Worms love leaves, so.
So how do you compare leaves and straw? See, somebody can't get leaves near them, but they could buy straw bales for pretty cheap.
Well, the problem with straw is whether it's been sprayed or not. If it's very old, okay? Old is very, very good too, because If there's lots of seeds in it, the wheat seeds will actually come up, but it's pretty easy to actually weed out the actual wheat and oats and things that from that. But yes, you can definitely use that, but generally everything's sprayed. So you're getting concentrations of glyphosate in things, unless you can actually get fields that haven't been sprayed, but good luck.
And so straw versus hay?
Well, the straw has less of the grains in it, so you're going to have less hay. But you can usually try to find some farmer that has some old moldy stuff. Or if you wanted the actual premium, okay, what you do is you get silage. Now, silage is sauerkraut for cows, okay? What they do is they take stuff that has like all the weeds and, you know, the crappy stuff from the sides of swamps and stuff with their hay, and they'll actually harvest it while it's wet. And then they cover it up in plastic and it ferments. And they give that straw to the cows in the wintertime. They get 50% more milk. And the cows don't need any antibiotics. This is they're actually starting to spray fields. They're inoculating straw fields and making silage with certain types of bacteria because of the fermented grains and grasses are making the cows so healthy.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, this is basically their natural diets, you know, before we start feeding them corn and soy and things.
Yeah.
Like, especially genetically modified.
Yeah, so the olden days, they used silage. Wow. And that's what they used in the wintertime. It's just like the old timers here.
And you could just spread that on your ground instead of the leaves, and it'd be better than the hay or the straw.
Correct.
And provided it's not sprayed.
Correct. Now, according to science, and it's the same lines as how bumblebees can't fly, water can't make it through the leaves, just like bumblebees can't fly. So, that's bullshit. You do not need to chop up the leaves, okay? Just get them down, the water will work its way down.
Right, yeah, so I mean, I would say if you're heat composting, broken down leaves is probably better for a thermal-based heat composting, but in this situation, I would leave whole leaves. Is definitely the best because the whole leaves will cover the ground better and break down over time slowly. So, you know, where do you get all your leaves actually is my question.
I've collected literally tens of tons of leaves.
How many tons?
those big feedlot bags, I would collect up to 20 or 30 of those. I owned Maple Street. There's 17 of the biggest maple trees. They actually did movies on our street, on Maple Street. And I would bring these big feedlot bags and the people would take all of their leaves and they'd fill it in there and then they'd text me and I'd come with my crane truck and I'd pick up these bags of leaves and I'd drop them off in my ferment farm so I could hand spread them over the ground. It was spectacular.
So maple leaves, so like some people say you shouldn't use oak leaves, you shouldn't use maple leaves, you shouldn't use certain kind of leaves because of tannins and all these other things. What is your response to that?
Variety. I use whatever kinds that you can, providing that there was no doghouse nearby.
So no poop in there.
No dog, no animal poop. And walnut. Walnut has a compound called juglone.
Right.
And that could be used as a natural herbicide because it's quite phenomenal for things not wanting to grow in it. But so basically no walnut, but a big variety is good. It's good. Get some poplar. Poplar has its own kind of essence. Maple leaves is just like, if you can only have one type of leaf, go for the maple.
Go for the maple leaf. That's Canadian, yeah.
Eh? Oh, I'm so busted.
All right, cool. So you basically collect your leaves for free from neighbors that would normally throw them out and whatnot. And how would you say people should get their leaves, you know, if they're not able?
Talk to their neighbors that have maple trees. Like, do something nice for people that have trees, because my heart bleeds every time I see a tree being cut down in the city. We are punished as landowners in the city. We have to have these little teeny weeny green bins. People with big trees, people go and buy those houses and they say, oh, what an ugly tree. We have to clean the leaves or the roots are gonna grow somewhere. So all of our trees are just being mowed down. We no longer have the great estate trees that we used to have. It's one thing our forests being mowed down, but our city trees, it's just awful. Us humans, we're just killing everything.
Yeah, and leaves are a valuable resource. Maybe even you know, say, hey, if I rake up your leaves, can I have them?
Well,
you know,
yeah,
that'd be so like, who is gonna not do that? Then you got like endless leaves. You got a little bit more work, but hey, it's good to get good sunshine, fresh air, and put in some work because most people are couch potatoes, which I do not encourage.
But do remember, okay, you gotta think in the fall, getting those leaves, okay, acquiring them. You're only gonna have a few weeks to a month to grab as many leaves as you can. Always get about 30% more than what you want that you're going to be able to use. I collect about 200 bags just for my immediate.
And how many pounds do you think that is, or well, do you even guess?
If it rains, a bag of if it rains, a bag of leaves can weigh 100 pounds. You know, if they're light and fluffy and you had some little kids fill them, well then a bag of leaves is 20 pounds. So,
so 20 pounds.
An average you could say 35 pounds.
Times how many bags?
200.
Wow, that's a lot of weight there.
Yeah. No. I fill it up in my car sometimes, you know.
Like it's one carload.
Well, no, many cars. Many carloads, you know. They're going to be raking them up for a while. Getting them before Halloween is nice because then you don't end up with the little wrappers. And remember, any kind of leaves that you have, you're always going to get left over whatever plastics, whatever things. So, you know, you really, really get to get familiar with certain areas. But everybody will be so happy. Bring them a tomato and they'll actually set them aside for you. It's a good thing.
So, I guess once you get the leaves, then what do you do with them? Like, do you just lay them down on top in the wintertime or during the season? Or what was the best time to put your leaves on your garden to do this mulch garden?
Okay, twice a year. First of all, in the fall.
Once you collect them, so you bring them home.
Or if you have, this is what you save that 30% for, okay? Right now, I just remulched a few days ago, so that's why you're seeing so much extra fluff right now. Right now, from the fall, there's probably only an inch of leaves. There was like a foot of leaves compressed, so maybe 2 feet down to 1 foot.
So you literally put in 2 feet in the wintertime, then it basically got snowed on and compressed it down to 1 foot, and then they've been breaking down over the year.
Yeah, through the winter, you can stick your hand through the snow and through the top leaves, and you stick your hand in there, and it's this warm, beautiful life growing.
Yeah, I mean, it's like insulation for the soil, Mother Nature's insulation.
My carrots, my beets, my garlic, I plant big rows of that, and as I pitchfork through it in the wintertime, you know, I'm getting all of the beautiful, as long as you have the crowns of the carrots, and nothing's exposed above the ground. So a really good idea is to go in at the end of the summer and cover the crowns of your carrots and your beets with sand.
Oh, sand.
And then you use your leaves and you cover that over. So that when the first frosts that hit, you have actually put a little blanket on it. You put a little jacket on, okay? So the soil, just like putting a jacket over your skin, you know, you're not letting that flesh get exposed to the cold and the changes of temperature. You don't need a lot because it's not very cold yet. But then when the leaves fall, you've already got that little insulation, so all of that soil is still super live, like right from the microbes have just had a summer of partying their ass off. I mean, in this heat and everything, these leaves just go, all of that life just gobbles them over. There's no whitefly, there's no aphids that are bad, the whole garden works harmoniously, you know, and more life wins. Good life is a result of lots and lots of life.
Wow. So I will say that definitely inspecting your garden, I've seen very few bugs. I have seen some few bugs here and there, but I would expect a garden of this size with so many plants, like to have so many more bugs. I'm so impressed on actually how bug-free your garden is. So not to say that if you do this, you're gonna have no bugs, but I'm gonna say you're gonna have significantly less, and you know, the better you can make your soil, the better and happier, the healthier you could treat your plants, the more, you know, living the life and stress less life of your plants, you know, the more they're gonna be productive for you. So you actually have carrots and beets and garlic you harvest through the wintertime using this technique with the mulch and the
sand? I harvest them like up to a week or two before I plant.
Wow.
I'll actually have them. As long as the crowns, the part that pushes up above the ground, as long as that's covered over, as soon as it's exposed, then the slugs in the wintertime and the spring can say, oh, that's nice food to eat. But as long as it's covered over and under the ground, nothing's going to eat it. So that little bit of sand is good too, because it helps with the aeration of your bed. When you're doing carrots, very tricky. If you're going to have a blanket, you're not just going to sprinkle carrot seeds on. It's not going to work. So, in a nutshell, you collect, when you pitchfork your carrot beds and your beet beds, you make mountains and valleys. Okay, the valleys you stuffed with leaves. Okay, so the valley is getting stuffed and you actually walk in it till all of a sudden, just like Hawaiian islands, just the top of those underwater volcanoes is on the top, and you just make a little teeny line in the groove and you sprinkle your carrot seeds. Then you don't have the sidewall pressure, but you don't want to have too much organic matter, fresh organic matter, because you know all those sexy roots where you get all those fun carrots, okay, that's from nitrogen, so you don't want to have it too fresh. So 2 year old leaves are better, you know, something that's decomposed more.
Oh wow, so collect the leaves and maybe even store them for a year if you could have that much in reserve, you have that much storage space.
Correct, yeah, leaves when you do pot growing and in containers, I stuff the bottom inch or so with leaves all the time.
All your containers are stuffed with leaves on the bottom, and then you have your black mulch soil.
Then I have my super soil, and that's another whole
topic. Yeah. We didn't cut, maybe next year.
Yeah, because pot. Yeah. I'll show you the actual pot growing. It's absolutely amazing.
All right, cool. So if somebody can't get regular leaves, could they get like, you know, leaves and wood chips from the landscape, or is that the same thing as just leaves or not?
Okay, wood decomposing can make turpentine. Okay, so the hard bark mulch is better. Okay, pine needles will work, but that's more acidic. All right, but any kind of organic matter, anything, don't have exposed soil. If you have nothing but plastic bags,
you could use that too, but cover your soil.
No, did I say the P word? No, I don't know, plastics but
uncovered, or wrap it with plastic.
Yeah.
Or polypropylene.
Lambskin. No, shit. Okay, that's going sideways. And back on the topic.
Yeah. So nothing or plastic. Yeah. Wrapped.
But when we were talking about there being no bugs in the garden, this is actually a thick soup that we are in. There's billions of different kinds of spiders and bugs completely all through this whole garden. You know, and it's a good life that takes over from the bad. Okay, it's just like your gut. It's just like where I've transcended from growing the best soil. It's the same thing with your gut. You know, you have to put as much biodiversity, you got to put as much soil-based microorganisms into your gut, and that crowds out the bad bugs. Mm.
So getting back to the question is, wood chips with leaves versus straight leaves only?
I would take just leaves. Back to the argument with the worm. Is a worm gonna wanna live in wood chips compared to dry, bare soil compared to leaves?
Well, good, better, best is what I like to say.
Best, I have made great big bins, and I put excess leaves, hundreds of bags of leaves, and they have just sat and compressed into like peat moss blocks. Yeah. I have broken up that peat moss blocks and used it and grown carrots straight in it, just in those leaves, okay? Magnificent. No weeds, no nothing. Everything seemed to grow perfect in just the leaves.
Yeah, so that's like leaf mold compost. That's one of the highest levels of compost, and unfortunately, maybe if you live in, I think, a place in Maryland I want to visit makes that and gives and sells it or whatever.
Seaweed.
Yeah. Oh, seaweed or leaves.
You would end up getting a higher and higher concentration of salt.
Well, you have to wash it really well and have salt. A small percentage of that. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
But so, you know, here's the thing, like, try to get as many leaves as you guys can. I mean, this is something super important, and you know, I know there's a guy that does like wood chip gardening and stuff, and my personal belief is if you're doing trees, wood chips are great for trees, but the leaves are better for the vegetables.
Yeah, but straw, if you can find anybody that has farmers with old rotting straw.
So straw is better than wood chips, but correct. Not as good as leaves, and make sure it's not sprayed. Yeah. Know the source.
Yeah, because good old glyphosate, right?
Yeah. You know? So getting back to the topic, so you're spreading out the leaves in the fall like 2 feet it's going to get snowed on, or if you live somewhere where it doesn't snow, it just rains, it's going to get rained on, it's going to break down over the winter time. Then come the spring, then you start to replant.
Then you have blanket. It's a blank. It's an organic blanket.
And then you're just going to peel that back?
Pre-start your plants.
In
Canada here, we pre-start things indoors because it's still cold. So, you know, we have
little starter plants inside, or if you're like me,
cold frames.
I don't have time to do that. I just go,
go to the nursery and buy a bunch of
plants.
And even if they've been sprayed, and even if they're not GMO, clean seeds, whatever, when you grow your food, you know, in super soil, it doesn't matter. It's being grown. Well, they're not going to do any genetically modified tomato seeds unless they crossed with an apple or a raccoon or something. At this point.
So you're going to peel back the blanket, plant your stuff, and then you're going to put the blanket back, or you're going to put new stuff
on, or what?
Yeah,
just poke a little hole. Yeah, just poke a little hole, a knife. I got a little sex stick, I call it, and I've got these plugs that I use, and I have all kinds of various plants that are grown in the same little, those same little wedgy thingies that they have for planting trees. So that
with
works.
With the long roots.
Yeah. So the roots are forced to go down, and then you just go with the sharp pokey stick and you drop it just like you're planting a tree.
Everybody knows how to so that's trees. Minimal soil, like, you know, disturbance.
Yeah.
That's cool. I got to check that out, actually. That's another thing I should have learned about. All right, cool. So then that's one time. And then when do you reapply the new leaves that you've stored, that 30% extra?
That is like right now.
Oh, right now.
Okay, right now, we've had all of this time. It's top dead center time of the summer. All of those leaves from this much down to like this much, okay? And then there'll be only like three leaves over top of this black, brown,
broken
super
down.
Because in this heat, just like fermenting, anything in is temperature oriented. So the trick is to get something over it now. And I had so many bags of leaves left over from last year. So it's like, I'm on my game. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, it looks amazing. Everything is mulch.
Yeah,
really
there's
heavy.
No weeds.
Like, that's the other thing. There's like no weeds literally in your garden because you do mulch it. And when you see a weed, you pull it so the seeds don't spread, which is something I just did before I left my house. Because I don't want my chinopodiums,
That's why gardening phased out over my generation, weeding. Yeah. And that's because our parents and our parents' parents started not doing the laying fallow, where they would grind everything up and they just leave it for a year. They let all those weeds grow and everything. They had so much land. Now we don't have land anymore. So Monsanto won, lost in the end, but they're winning because they just found that more and more chemicals to kill off things. Like, it's just horrific because it's also done that to our guts. We get it in everything, but I'm not going to get on that one. But anyway, so more life wins. Because we have Monsanto in everything, we have to put life back into our gut. We have to do special things. You know, fermented foods, kefirs.
Well, we're going to talk about that segment, getting back to the mulching. So when you mulch, do you mulch up to the stem? And I mean, I know on some of the plant, on the, like the kale, you've literally mulched all the up to the leaves. So I mean, really, I'm not even seeing anything. Do you have any problems with slugs or bugs getting into a nice habitat right next to the mulch and living there and eating stuff and not being disturbed?
Well, there's things that eat the slugs. And they live there too, so everything takes care of itself. You mean, if you make yourself a spaceship, which is basically what a greenhouse is, you have got every kind of thing that can happen wrong. Just like you don't want to have a house plant that you go and put in your garden and then you take it back in with your hundreds of house plants. It's like taking things out into the jungle, and then all of a sudden you're getting all these jungle creatures and you're bringing them up into your house, and it's like, yeah. All you need is a mealybug or a aphid colony going through your yucca forest in your house. 6 months of wiping off leaves with safer soap for every few days, trying to get rid of it. You'll never do that again.
So how long did it take for your system to stabilize where you noticed little bug problems? Because I'm sure when you started, right, you didn't have all the habitat, all the creatures, all the living things. You know, and it's all happened over time.
Well, I re-inoculated. I had like 200 square feet of my little mulch garden that I had for the first 10 years. And then this last 20 years has been just this. I took handfuls, just like a yogurt starter, and inoculate. I inoculated the soil before I put the leaves down in the fall. I took horse shit. I got 14 loads of horse shit, and I rototilled it into a hard-packed lawn of a predominantly field bunch weed, or otherwise known as morning glory. And you know you can't kill that stuff, right? Yes, you can. Anyways.
So that was a one-time rototilling and application of the manure that just to kind of get it started.
Getting the organic matter into this hard pack, you know, 80-year-old hard pack of shit. It was just clay and dirt and just nothing. It was an awful piece of dirt. So, and in the first year I had these old gardeners coming by, and somebody nominated it for Green Thumbs Garden Award. And I couldn't get these gardeners, these old gardeners, they were just like amazed. But I was sort of crippled. I had a leg smacked out from under me I was walking on one leg, so I had a whole year, and I planned everything around the sun. So everything is south. So you see how these are all curved?
Yeah.
Okay? It's all curved so that as the sun's coming up here, it has that curve. And everything, and all the beds are planted in such a way that you have a walkway that from one side of the walkway, you reach in as far as you can, you go to the other walkway and you reach in as far as you can. Okay? That is your bed. Okay? So that you actually have identified places that you can walk. And you make your pathways out of something that you remulch again. Because just like the brain and its neural networking, you want all of that fungi to start connecting, interconnecting through it all. Because then your whole garden becomes like an actual brain.
Just like a living forest. System, yeah.
Just like a forest. The fungi is going to, from one end of the garden, is going to communicate with
the
other.
What about the fung girls? They got to communicate too? They communicate right here in this area.
Do you think I made this century area for? A major street there. Can you see the street? Yeah, no.
Cool. That's so awesome. Yeah, I mean, I noticed that they're all like, you know, you have a really cool past, but there's more method to the madness that I didn't even get to cover in my video on how the sun goes. And Mike, what are some other tips that you really want to give gardeners here since we're getting some of your wisdom, which is, you know,
I hit some pretty good ones. You don't want to disturb it. It's just like if you take a rotor tiller to your brain, right? It's not going to be able to connect so much. You actually create, everything's all about life, right? And by creating a place for plants to grow, and by maintaining and feeding this brain with all this leaves, you create something out of the universe. And any of the food here, you know, that I use as much as I can in my ferments, is super. It's all super duper.
Yeah, no, I mean, I gotta say, I did say earlier in the video where I tasted some of your lettuce, and I've been to, like, just earlier this year, a couple months ago, I was at an aquaponics farm, hydroponics farm, they're all growing lettuce.
Yeah.
Like, that lettuce tastes like nothing to me. Your lettuce actually tastes good. Like, yeah. it's some of the best lettuce I've had, and you probably got some of the best soil here in Kelowna.
Well, this is like the happiest place. I try to create the happiest place on the planet for plants to grow.
So it's apparent to me, Daniel, that you're basically trying to create literally a living system here with microbes and bacteria and fungi, like living in your soil, on your plants, and they do a lot of the work for you in your garden. But in addition, you kind of bring that into your personal life to help local people in the area with your company bring in some of the microbes into their personal space. So much like we need microbes for our soil and our garden to function and thrive properly, we also need these microbes within us. And when I eat any of the leaves or fruits out of his garden, I'm getting some of these endogenous microbes that are living on the plants in me now. But in addition, you take that to the next level by having moonstone ferments, where you basically use some of the produce you grow here and you ferment them and sell that to the local people so that they could get some of the microbiome and some of this life within them so that they could be healthy. You want to talk about that for a minute?
Well, I call it moonstone ferments because I do everything in stone or glass or wood, because the androgenic disruptors in plastics are known to duplicate estrogen. It's just horrible, horrible things. And even stainless steel, you can't ferment in stainless steel because there's ions. You know, that's like babies trying to grow in electrical storms. So stone, old stone crocks and glass and wood is a healthy place where the enzymes is like the the life, that's life force. They live for seconds, nothing lives past a minute. And there's billions and billions of different kinds that are all going like crazy all the time. That's life force. Now, every living organism has enzymes on it that will eat it. Okay, so if you have a garlic and a carrot and a onion, they all have different types of enzymes that will eat it. So when I make my ferments, I try to incorporate various things, you know, and as many soil-based carrying microorganisms as possible, because just your basic cabbage has a vast amount, maybe 600 different kinds of bacteria and yeast in it. But you can end up with all kinds of different ones from the carrots and the beets and stuff. So anyways, my Moonstone ferments, there's a lot of science that's put into it. Like the kale that I grow from my garden here and rosemary, that has yeasts, okay? Because just like good bacteria will crowd out bad bacteria from your gut, same thing with yeasts. And we're all candida factories. We got sugar and everything. It's mandated that corporations have to sell something that's going to taste good rather than be good. So we're walking around candida factories because that's a natural yeast too, but with glyphosate and everywhere, we end up with too much. So we need to have good yeasts put into us as well. So the yeasts on the kale, just like wine is flavored by the yeasts off of the grape, right? I put kale in all of my ferments. So that's why I've got a row of just big kale. And I love your shirt there.
Yeah.
every day I'm kaling it.
Add some of your kale today, it's good too.
Yeah. So the kale's in everything, and it's for the yeast. So every single component goes into my ferments. It's rocket surgery. I mean, everything is thought out. Soil-based microorganisms, it's my book called Mind the Gap. It's all about the separation, this huge gap that we have between the earth and the gut. And these are just our meat suits. And we just tell this taxi where to go. But it's a piece of the earth and society. We're no longer getting soil-based microorganisms from the water that we drink. Yep. It's all filtered and chemically purified, and it's just awful. We used to get soil-based microorganisms just from the creek and the well water.
And B12 in there.
Yeah. Yep. Oh, yeah. So
uncontaminated, of course.
Uncontaminated, yes. So it might be simple, like drinking creek water might cure cancer. It might be that simple. But anyways, we're not getting it from the water. We're not getting it from the air. Before wind would blow, we've got soil blowing up. We have, you know, the earth. So much stuff is blowing around, and we're inhaling it from the air. So we're not getting that anymore. You know, we're in the 12th story of some apartment in downtown Vancouver.
We're breathing car exhaust, diesel exhaust.
But that's brake pads, and you know, and then our foods. You know, there's something horrific right there. You know, we've got glyphosate and everything, which is an antibiotic to our guts. So all of our food is actually bombarded with radiation at the border, so that it kills off more of the bacteria on the outsides. All of this, so we're not getting, our guts are sterile. We've just become with this desert wasteland, and something is always going to grow. So we end up with bad things growing in it. So the whole trick is just to put good things in, and as many different types as possible. Variety trumps. Oh, did I say the Trump word? Variety.
We're in Canada. It's all right.
Is it?
Wait, is Trudeau. It? Wait, can I say Trudeau?
No, that's no. Actually, Trudeau for this. No. Oops. more bad segues. Variety trumps over quality and quantity. Yeah.
I always say eat as much variety, grow all the different kinds of things as you can.
And you don't need a lot. You can have a little teeny weeny teaspoon of a beet and a radish and a garlic and a something. And they might not be organic or whatever. It's going to be way better than just eating a whole big organic apple. But mind you, apples are very good for you. You know, if you can eat an apple a day, there you go.
Fresh, a fresh harvest.
And the whole apple.
Not cold storage.
You don't have to eat the stem. But no, even cold storage ones. But eat the whole apple, okay? Because the fiber of that makes it through your body.
The life force in cold storage apples are just...
They're actually...
And they're oxygen deprived cold storage.
Oxygen deprived cork. Yeah. Okay. Well, that's things I don't.
Modified environment.
Ignorance is bliss. Eat an apple a day. Okay, because the fiber gets into the small intestines, down lower in your intestines, and that's where we want lots of good bacteria. And the it's critical. It's critical. Fiber is very, very good. Just that old saying, an apple a day, is.
I agree. Apples are good. Especially the skin. If you could just eat apple skins all day, it's even better. But
I think the inside too. The seeds.
Oh, the seeds,
because
yeah.
Remember, seeds are stored life force.
Yeah, no, I, right? I
the
eat
life, the
apricot
potential
seeds.
Life force. Yeah, oh, for
have
the
some,
for,
yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
Land trail in there. So, yeah, I didn't have any today. But big question. So I know you're in the business of selling ferment. So what would you say to people that say, oh, fermented foods, I don't need that, or it's just rotted vegetables. I don't need to eat rotted food. And they think it's like of no use or bad for us.
Well, if you believe to what all ancestors or every ethnic community, all religions, they all say basically that there's like spirits in some way, shape, or form. When you eat fermented foods, you actually have all of your ancestors speaking through you, saying, "Ah, I remember that." You know, because fermented foods has been around since we crawled out of caves. It's a magic that just happens to make them preserved. So it's pre-digested. All our ancients were super wise. They always used bacterias and funguses and yeasts to pre-digest foods so that our bodies would be able to process it. And also, if it's acidic or alcohol, it preserves it, because everybody back then, food poisoning, you died. I mean, it was
right. That's why I guess what in the olden days they drank beer instead of water, because it was like you know you fermented it and now you had water, but you also got alcohol.
Our ancients were wise. They made potions. They made tinctures. I've got this master tonic, which is phenomenal, and it uses 7 of the top 10 natural antibiotics: garlic, ginger, horseradish, turmeric, onions, all infused in apple cider vinegar, so in an acid. Okay, so the essences of all of those things, all of the healing properties of all those, gets put into the apple cider vinegar, the acid. So then you can carry around a little bottle that you're not going to stink in. It'll last forever. So all of these things, and then of course alcohol does the same thing. Alcool means spirit taker, but alcohol makes your gut permeable. It actually gives you leaky gut.
So it's not, alcohol is not, yeah.
It's a poison.
I don't call alcohol a health food personally.
Well, it's the amount of joy that it can bring you, the amount of stress released, yeah, sure. But generally, it's gonna kill you. It's the number one thing sorry. I mean, I love, I'm an old wino, I guess I say. I love booze, I love the feel of it, I love all of that. I also know how bad it is. So, you know, sticking to my solid, my flexitarian rules where I can have anything that I want as long as I have a completely open mind about it. But, you know, the addiction of it and how it's just out there to kill us. You know, how big business and the corporations, everything's
all designed. One fermented food I would abstain from and not encourage. But to each their own.
Yeah. No, 2 drinks a day is not actually okay. You know, 2 drinks a day, you're putting poison in your body twice a day. So, you know, that's like every single day. So, just be aware.
Cool. So, getting back to ferments, any other comments you'd like to quickly share about the fermented foods and why people should even make them themselves? And actually, why you want to teach people how to do this, right?
Well, I've created the Institute of Natural Fermentation. Where my end game, rather than just making sauerkraut, oh great, 50 years down the road, oh, this guy was a sauerkraut king, you know, he healed lots of people, big deal. The Institute of Natural Fermentation is, the end game is to teach people to teach people to do it. We need to bring this back. We need it standardized. We need it totally supported. If the power went out, if 3 volcanoes pop off and we've got smoke in the air for a few years, every little bit of food, or having no power, he who has the most crocks full wins.
How about freeze-dried food wins?
Well, the freeze-drying costs, it's uses
power. Yeah, more
power.
Labor intensive.
It uses power.
Yeah. While
cutting,
you have it.
Cutting cabbage, putting it into a stone vessel, okay? with no temperature changes.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's count the power that it took.
I'm not.
Yeah.
Fermentation wins on that level.
Yeah. So
everything has its pros and cons.
Yeah. So it's let's see.
So how are you going to teach people from this? Do you have like a website? Starting something?
I've been giving classes for 8 years.
Oh, cool. And so you still give classes today, and how can somebody learn?
This fall I'll be starting up again. I've been revamping. I started off with people coming to my house, and it was taking. I worked it out that it was like 4 hours a week, and I figured I'm just going to have a class. So I load up my water kefir and my kombuchas and my milk kefir and my sprouts and some krauts and kimchis and started giving this all about the gut class. So I created it's all about the gut.com. Good one to own.
Oh, and your other one is what? Mulchgardening.com,
well,
right?
I did that, you know, way back. That was 19 years ago. So I piggybacked all of these other websites off of my mulchgardening.com. It was actually organic mulch gardening at first, but I can't do that because I have to pay $400 in regulations and blah blah blah, and it's just not my gig. So anyways, teaching people certification programs in fermenting. Okay, bang, people got to know how to make their sauerkrauts. If the power went out, if a volcano's popped off, every little bit of food, how are you going to keep that? I have jars of sauerkraut that sit outside here. And the top half looks pretty sketchy. I would comfortably eat the bottom third. And all it does is good life has taken over from the bad. Civilizations have grown over top of other civilizations. So even they did research with sauerkraut in seniors, assisted seniors places, and they found that people that ate cooked sauerkraut, people that had live sauerkraut, and people that had no sauerkraut. And the people that had no sauerkraut got sick 3 times, people that had cooked sauerkraut got sick twice, and people that got
the live sauerkraut
didn't get sick.
Wow, that's why you eat live sauerkraut.
They got sick once. Okay, no sauerkraut, sick 3 times. Cooked sauerkraut, sick twice, and no live sauerkraut, one.
So, do you want to be sick or not?
Yeah, and that's just a simple thing. There's so many good things about sauerkraut.
Cool. Yeah. So if somebody wants to learn about your classes or whatever, how can they do that?
Sandor Katz. He's the man.
All right.
He signed Big Larry, the world's biggest cucumber.
I'll put a link down below. Actually, I did a video. I interviewed Sandor actually at an event I was at, so I'll put a link down below.
Yeah.
That's an excellent video right there on fermentation.
Yeah, and then get his new book. He made a second edition of Wild Fermentation. And,
oh, wow.
And me and Big Larry are in it. Oh, cool. The world's biggest pickle. Cucumber turned into pickle.
Yeah, he grew the biggest cucumber that you turned into a pickle here, yeah. Too. I didn't get the show. He's kind of got the remnants.
Yeah.
Larry had an accident.
Not so anyway, he had a
not
good
so
life.
Big
he's
anymore.
Well worn. Yeah. And Good Morning America did a really good show of it. I had like the population of Canada all pissing themselves laughing one morning, and I felt the cosmic energy of that one Thursday morning. I wake up, I felt really weird and realized that Good Morning America had just done a show on it.
Oh, yeah. Cool. Right on.
Anyway.
So any final words or comments? If somebody wants to learn about your moonstone ferments or anything about you, websites, how can they contact you? If they have any questions, all this stuff?
Yeah.
Or not?
I'm going to be really, really good this winter. But right now I'm going to focus on my book. And the people that I have hooked on my sauerkraut, I feel obligated to that because my stuff has 10 times more life than the other live sauerkrauts that you can buy in the store. So get your local, get your own terroir, don't ferment in plastics and stainless steel unless you have no other choice. Okay, I've been to other places in different countries, you can't get glass. Okay,
wow.
You're better off to get fermented things in plastic jugs than not fermented.
Yeah, I mean, mason jars, that's I usually ferment in mason jars with vacuum lids because they're just really simple and easy. I'll put a link down below if I remember to a video I made fermenting my stuff. Every year I ferment things, whether it's peppers or I make kimchi that I have sitting in my counter. I have a couple of those old jars that I comfortably feel good about eating the bottom half, but not the top, half as well. Yeah. And it gets really
soft and mushy. Dry it and powder it.
Oh, freeze-dried. Oh, freeze-dried is amazing. Yeah. So anyways,
we'll get into that now.
We'll talk about that more. So I look forward to coming back next year. Hopefully you have your book, you have more info, and I want to see some of those tools, and we'll be able to share more with you guys.
Those probiotics, those probiotics have 10 types of bacteria in it. My sauerkraut might have 1,000 different types of bacteria and yeast. Dr. Mercola's had 680. And two mouthfuls is 1.5 trillion. A whole box is a trillion. So really, when it comes to eating live sauerkraut and live fermented foods, those throw away your pills. It's just a whole bunch of psychobabble that we've been indoctrinated by the doctors. Mm.
I think each different kind of probiotic has a benefit, and you know, I take some, actually the probiotic pills I take are actually just fermented foods in a pill with a wrap around it so that it doesn't go bad.
Yeah.
Actually, it's not actually some freeze-dried white crystalline powder.
Yeah, but still, live is always
better. It is live.
Yeah. I eat mushrooms, but mushrooms are different. That's spores. Spores is a different matter. That's the only pills that I have.
We could talk all day about this, but definitely had a fun time. Hey, if you guys had a fun time on this journey, visiting Daniel's Angel's Roost and visiting his garden, hearing from him, learning from him, hey, please give a thumbs up. If I get 1,000 thumbs up, I'm going to come back next year for sure. You'll see, share this video with other people so that they can learn about mulch gardening, which is truly, I think, one of the answers to gardening in the best way possible to grow the highest quality food. And my taste buds have definitely tasted it today, along with some friends I have traveling with me. They definitely agree that it's some of the best leafy greens that they tasted, and they're not necessarily leafy green eaters themselves. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that have come out every maybe 3 to 4 days, maybe up to every week. You never know where I'll show up or what we'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,400 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel dedicated to teach you guys the best way to grow your food as possible. And I'm glad to got to share your mulch garden today, because that is so important with the leaves, all right? So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.